Welcome back. You're still watching Daybreak on this fifth day of December 2023. And in studio, we're talking about the government financing options, the latest being the privatization of some 11 state corporations. Of course, there has been an order by the High Court stopping application of part of that law, meaning that the privatization may not continue at the moment. And Fred, we were talking about the justification and also looking at the list of those institutions that are earmarked for privatization. I don't know what your thoughts are on what Kenyans need to be aware of. And is this a purely Government of Kenya idea?
Thank you. Thank you, Sam. I think, first of all, let's appreciate that this is an issue before a court of competent jurisdiction currently, and the petitioner ODM has gotten conservative orders stopping that process from going on. So without even going into the merits and demerits of the case, but there are certain fundamental facts that we have to agree. The process of privatization is to transfer assets. Now, if you look at right from the formulation of the privatization program all the way to the completion of the process, it requires the people to participate. Right from the act, if you check section 19, as you go 20, 21, all the way, the people are required to participate because of our principles of governance and national values. Now, the main issue here is the CS National Treasury and Economic Planning has identified entities. To me, some of those entities are sovereign assets. And therefore, these
all of them are
sovereign assets.
All of them?
Some of them. Mm-hmm. So if you look at them, in terms of privatization, then the threshold of public participation must be very high. And that's why you hear the petitioner arguing the other that the nature of public participation that was involved must be of a higher threshold akin to a referendum. But the main concern is when the CS National Treasury provided the program for privatization, the requirement is that once that program is approved by the cabinet, then it shall be ratified by parliament. So Dr. Makalia has given you the type of parliament we have and what happens. Majority have their way, minority have their say. And we have seen what happens in that parliament. Was the ratification above board by members of parliament? That's a question that is being raised. Number two, the level of participation of the people. Given that some of these assets that are going to be privatized or proposed for privatization are considered sovereign, KICC, KLB, Kenya Seed, they are actually part of the sovereign wealth of this country. Mm-hmm. And therefore, I don't think, in my view, privatization is bad. But the process of privatization must meet certain constitutional threshold so that it is above board. And therein, there is the participation of the people that has been raised. Thirdly, the reason why the Kenya Kwanza government is now going for this privatization is more of what they call economic perspective to bridge the gap. But in the constitution of Kenya, does that come above the issues of national governance and public participation, for example? Mm-hmm. So the court will be trying to look at, is the economic perspective superior to the national values and principle of governance in doing anything as pertaining to the public? Those are questions that the public will be hearing and would want to be answered. And lastly, Sam, I also think that Kenyans have not been told exactly why. Because Kenyans just know that we are selling KICC. KICC was gazetted as a national, whatever. It is now being sold. We are selling Kenya Seed. We are selling Kenya Little Below. They are Kenya. So somebody would argue, a layman, why are we selling Kenya? That's the layman's argument. So if you look at these, there are actually serious issues of concern to the people. And therefore, I am happy that a petition has gone to court to seek some relief. And some of the relief is, look at the what is economic perspective subordinate to national values? Was the public involved? What is the threshold? Mm-hmm. And so on and so forth. So let's allow the court also to give us the interpretation and a verdict on this issue. But in the meantime, there is an order stopping it. I strongly believe that when privatization is done in a process that is justifiable, right from the program that has been tabled, approved by cabinet, tabled in parliament, and all the way to give a justification that when you do this process, mm-hmm. then Kenyans will benefit, not leaders, not individuals, not foreigners, then Kenyans can agree that let's go privatization away because it is something that has been seen to be working elsewhere.
Okay, interesting. And for you, Javas, so when you look at it and knowing...
I wanted, with your permission, Fred here to... He has used some two terms, yeah? Mm-hmm. Sovereign asset, I've never heard about that one. And I would like him to teach me a little bit about what sovereign asset is. Mm-hmm. And the second thing he has mm-hmm. said that mm-hmm. there is a problem mm-hmm. When the name of an organization starts with the word Kenya, it should not be privatized. And we have very many companies mm-hmm. that start with the word Kenya that are private. No. I can name 30 of them, you know, Kenya Nut, Kenya Water, they are all private companies.
Kenya Water.
So okay.
Sam,
so,
I think Mandela did not listen.
So I think, you know, I don't want, you know, okay. What I don't want to do is, we are in a national, you know.
Okay. We owe the public.
I think it's a fair question.
Yeah, it's a fair question.
And we owe the, don't want to mislead
absolutely.
People
mm-hmm.
that because something is called Kenya, mm-hmm. it should not be sold. Then I also do not understand what's
okay, okay. Let me start from the last one. Mm-hmm. I said, the layman out there who do not understand what is going on, when they hear anything mentioned Kenya, they believe that maybe these people are selling Kenya. That is a layman's argument, and I've seen those on social media.
Please tell
so
them that's,
we
that's
owe,
not happening.
We
Please
owe the public an
TV.
Explanation.
That's not happening.
But we know for sure that KICC is one of the sovereign assets. We know that, and it contributes to the sovereign wealth. And I'll tell you what sovereign asset is. Sovereign assets are assets that are owned by the public, they are in statute. And in the constitution of Kenya, we all know the sovereignty of this country belongs to the people of Kenya. And therefore, those assets are believed to be owned by Kenya while they are managed by the government. That's what I mean. The interpretation that the court will be seeking is, are these assets owned by the people of Kenya or by the government? And if so, what is the process involved in disposing or privatizing such assets? Of course, in reference to the act that was enacted by Parliament.
So you're talking about public assets?
That's what I'm saying.
Because the sovereign asset is an invention of Fred, but
no,
that's
no,
okay,
no.
We'll let him have it. They are called public assets.
One doesn't need to read widely and understand some of these things.
You know,
we'll let Okango have it. But there's no word like sovereign assets. So, they're public assets.
I think
they are parastatals or public assets.
I think we need to define the word sovereign. So please find the definition and tell us how that relates to the assets that
we have. Absolutely.
Javas, talk to me about, because there has been several efforts, and Dr. Makali Mulu here says that the government can source its revenues from tax loans, sale of assets, or the appropriations in aid. But when this is happening, I remember that during the first term of President Kenyatta II, that is, there was talk about all these overlapping state corporations and how they needed to be rationalized, maybe merge some or drop off some. It never really happened. Now here we are with the proposal to sell some of these assets. How much of this is actually the intervention or the action, deliberate action by the government of Kenya, or is it pressure from international organizations?
Well, Sam, any schooled eye, just as much as an unschooled eye, will appreciate that we are in an economic distress. And the circumstance and the reality of the economic turmoil in which we are cannot be gainsaid. And appreciating that when it comes to matters privatization, as has been discussed here, belabored by my co-panelists this morning, we need to appreciate that the matter of privatization is a revenue-raising rivulet. And that's what the government is aiming at. And also when you appreciate the various the justification mm-hmm. that has been provided in the privatization program. Now, of course, we have got multiple parastatals mm-hmm. and some that one could say are duplicitous in terms of the kind of programs that a merger would make much more sense. And I think when we look at the manner in which colossal amounts are used by the government mm-hmm. to run and sustain some of these entities, it would make sense that, well, a question of merger of some would be very vital. Mm-hmm. Secondly, the aspect of privatization. Now, of course, it is important as altogether curious, the way my relative Okango is hovering here, that the issue of privatization calls for public participation that is akin to a referendum. I don't know whether it's important for us to draw parallels, but the utility of the word akin to a referendum itself, I think, creates a loss of thought, because a referendum for purposes of privatization, one would argue, when it comes to nationalization, would you also require such kind of effort? I'm sure you would not. But the argument that has been made by the petitioners in the issue that has been now granted conservatory orders by Justice Mwita, of course, raise critical issues of law mm. and constitution. And I agree, because when you look at even the Privatization Act, there's the issue of public participation, there's the issue of being pliant to Article 201 of the Constitution on the principles of public finance management, there's the issue of being pliant to the principles of good governance in Article 10 of the Constitution, and those are critical issues of government, of governance. Those principles of governance are pillars of good governance in this country. However, we must also appreciate that perpetually, our coquetry with hollow politics is what also leads us into the kind of drain that we find ourselves. Now, the game of musical chairs. It is important for Honorable Raila Odinga and ODM, as Okango argues, that they raise critical issues of public interest mm-hmm. about some of these assets. Yes, on the 26th of July, 2013, Honorable Wario, Cabinet Secretary for Sports and Culture, as he then was, gazetted the KICC as a national monument. Well, of course, we know any gazette notice can be degazetted. Mm-hmm. But yes, the KICC has got sentimental value and national symbolism, even in our legal tender, and that's crucial. But we also appreciate that there are some other parastatals whose disposition in whole or part of their assets or sale of stakes in those assets would help us pull our socks up to around the anklets in the economic circumstances that we find ourselves in, especially mm-hmm. the debt burden that we are in.
Interesting. You know, you say that you're relatives with Okango. I also take
note. We are political relatives.
I also take note of the suits. moving on, because this is not the first time this is coming up. And Mheshimiwa Makali, once upon a time, you may know it, Kisumu Cotton Mills, Kikomi. It was a private entity.
Yes.
And then in the 80s, it was nationalized so that it could contribute to the exchequer revenues. Mm. Then again, later, it was taken back to the private hands. Mm. And there was that ping pong sort of game, and mismanagement led it to where it is today. It's just a rusty shell, nothing happening there. So how shall we safeguard to ensure that it is not a political opinion that is at play here to privatize, but maybe in the future, other governments or administrations may come in and say, we want it back to the national hands, and in between, losing a lot of value and time and resources.
Okay, thank you, Sam. Maybe before I get to that question, Sam, just a bit of clarification on a number of issues. You know, when you look at the parastatals and you want to categorize them, There are those who are providing some social benefit. There are those who are playing the greater role. And there are those which are now purely in investment. And I think the focus here should be on parastatals which are more playing the role of just investment, mm-hmm. business, like you were saying. Mm-hmm. And that's what we need to ask ourselves. Are we getting any dividends as a result of this parastatal being in place? So that if we are not, and they always, you know, like the other day we were discussing the KQ, and we discussed KQ here with you, where every year
through budgeting, we are pumping billions of shillings to KQ.
Mm-hmm.
We always say it's a strategic parastato, but at the end of the day, the money being pumped there every year in and out can easily do better roads, can do better hospitals, and that's what we need to do in terms of balancing. But this process now, Sam, mm-hmm. To avoid being political, if we took a bit of time and look at the law, this new act, actually it's very clear what needs to be done. And I said, you know, being clear on what needs to be done and what is being done is a different matter. So for me, for example, there's a transitional arrangement in that law. Because we were asking ourselves, before we reviewed this law, there were parastatals which were lined up for privatization.
Mm-hmm.
What happens to them? Now, there's a transitional arrangement where we are saying that whatever had been agreed before the law is already null and void. So this law, we are going to get a new listing, and that's what you've seen on the list they have published. What is expected is after publishing this list, it will go to the cabinet. The cabinet needs to approve. Once approved by the cabinet, now Treasury, with the new authority which has been created in this law, is now supposed to subject those 11 parastatals to a program.
Okay.
A program where they will tell Kenyans what are the benefits of this privatization. How much are we going to save by doing this from the exchequer releases? And after convincing now Kenyans that this is the program and these are the benefits and there is no creating of monopolies as a result of this,
right?
Then they will do the bit as an executive. They go through public participation executive.
Mm-hmm.
Then that is supposed to be handed over now to the National Assembly, which will actually carry almost like a parallel program. Through now the committee where I'm the vice chair, will provide leadership in the same program.
Okay.
Look at the benefit to the country, analyze are there any risks, do public participation again as parliament, and then take it to the House for approval. Now, I said the only problem I see, and I agree with those who are saying let's go to court early enough, is because there's a situation where we might come to our side as parliament, and my colleague will agree, and then you find that we don't do the due diligence from a parliamentary side,
okay,
because of our own internal challenges which we are facing. But to me, I think really basically, as you said, this time I don't think there's any pressure from IMF. Initially, there was a bit of pressure. You remember, at some point, the World Bank and IMF did say that you need to restructure the universities.
Mm-hmm.
You remember at some point?
Mm-hmm.
That was pressure coming from. But I think this one, even though they are saying reduce the budget deficit, I don't think even despite their pressure that Kenya should give in to that pressure because we have a very clear program of what needs to be done.
Okay.
So if we adhere to that program, I can tell you for sure, at the end of the day, we'll be able to isolate those parastatals like which are national, like what you think, the KICC. KICC might not need to be privatized on the basis of returns, which will come from it. But it might not. We might say no to it because of what you're saying, sentimental kind of arrangement, issues of it being the history attached to it, even to an extent that it appears in our legal tender, the notes and all that. So on the basis of it, we can say no, the private interest, the social interest outweighs
if private hands were to buy that property,
yes,
they have the right to even make changes.
Obviously. Once you buy it, if you become private, you're private. It's just like your house. You can change whatever room you
right now, Sam. I'll add to what Mheshimiwa is saying.
Yes.
Yes.
That, you see, when it comes to a critical asset of national sentimental value such as KICC, and it gets to be entirely owned by a private sector or a private entity.
Mm-hmm.
Remember then there are data protection issues that will emerge.
Okay.
For instance, somebody will claim that now that this is a private facility, why is it a prayer ring, for example, on money, and yet we have not had concurrence on this issue, and then it will lead to some kind of tussle that the trier of fact that the court is will want to determine. But remember that, Sam, from 1963, we have led a mixed economy.
Mm-hmm.
Where, for example, and this was in fact encouraged by Session Paper Number 10 of 1965, where we get to have the government, while it renders services, has got for purposes of, you know, engaging in and regulation of matters within the private sector, and also involvement of the private sector in matters governance, the issue of matters privatization and issues of matters nationalization emerged.
Okay,
and we will agree that nationalization of assets is not bad, privatization of assets is of our parastatals is not bad. And remember that when you're talking about privatization, it may just refer to selling particular stakes or percentage of stakes, not whole.
Okay.
So these are critical issues that the public may need to appreciate or to understand.
All right. Yeah. Now I want us to transition from that conversation. Mheshimiwa Ndeto, so we are now getting some facilities from the World Bank and the IMF. I understand that the World Bank is up to 2 trillion shillings across 3 years. For the World Bank, it's about just over 600 billion shillings. And there has been conversations. Economists warn that the conditionalities by these multilateral organizations may not be the best, because they come and tell you that, yes, for us to do this, there are certain structural adjustments you have to do. And we know the history of what has happened before. So at what cost are we getting this financing?
I was in the university when the first round of the structural adjustment programs were done in the early 90s. And it was very, very painful. We stopped getting free food, and we stopped getting very many other things free in the university at that point. Mm-hmm. Obviously, there is that suspicion from that history in terms of the relationship between Kenya and IMF, because it was all felt by everybody, the prescriptions, that the things that they prescribed that time, in a way, were actually detrimental to the welfare of very, very many Kenyans. And before I even go to the nitty-gritties, I think every country, Kenya included, should aim for managing its economy in a way that you require less and less of these external doctors. Because when a doctor comes, Sam, you don't come with a prescription to the doctor. Mm-hmm. You go and you wait for the doctor to prescribe. And sometimes not all prescriptions would necessarily be, not all pills that are administered will necessarily be good and sweet. Some will be bitter pills. But I want to say that the economy of this country has moved very many steps ahead from maybe where we were during Moi's time in the early 90s, when actually IMF coming to town was headline. It used to be headline literally in all the major dailies for a period of 3 or 4 days. Mm-hmm. But having said that, it is important to say, who is IMF? Who is World Bank? Because also understanding who they are and why they are such a big deal is very, very important. Or what we call them, the Bretton Woods institutions. Mm-hmm. And IMF plays a very, very important role in terms of facilitation of global trade, in terms of helping countries with things like balance of payments. So it's more of a fiscal and I would say actually fiscal policy sort of an intervention arm. And it's true Kenya has tapped quite some bit of money from IMF in the last few years. I think the latest now will be the $682 million, if I'm not wrong, which is coming under what they call the Resilience and Sustainability Fund, the RSF. And why is Kenya looking for this money? I think there could be several reasons. And I think the first one is we need to build buffers. As a country, we've suffered all these external shocks that we have had to deal with, the escalating fuel prices, America exporting its inflation all over the world. We are victims of that, just like anyone else in the world. We need to curb our own local inflation. We need to improve our debt vulnerability, which again, Sam, we've been very open that right now we are vulnerable. We also need to improve the ability of the economy to withstand external shocks, to reduce this dollar free fall. So you need to maybe shore up your foreign exchange reserves and things like that. And we also need to deal with emerging issues like climate change, which are all things that now are challenges that as a government that we need to confront. So Sam, when IMF comes or when we draw these facilities from IMF, we are not, in my opinion, there isn't any conditionalities that I'm aware of that have been put, but there will be, because of the role of IMF, which is basically to try and assist a country mm-hmm. with that microeconomic stability, there could be certain programs and programs that they could be agreeing with the government. But I don't want to see them, as conditionalities. For example, I know in this country, IMF has for a long time advised us, not put a condition, advised us because. But then they are an advisor globally. They not only advise Kenya government, they also advise the US government.
Advise yeah? Kenya that?
Advise us that we need to widen the tax base. That has been a big issue. We need to improve tax compliance. Okay? There has been issues of expenditure rationalization, which I think right now, you know that is happening.
So saying it's an advice, it's not a requirement?
It's not really a requirement.
So why do we comply? Why do you always comply?
We don't always comply. I'm not aware of that we've always complied to every IMF condition, because it's a negotiation. And, because they may come and say, we want you to do this. And we also say, the reason we are doing this is because of this and this. I know, for example, IMF is against things like subsidies. Because, they'll use the classic economic theory, that maybe you should not be, providing subsidies and transfers. Because that is not something we see happening a lot in the West.
Subsidies were removed. You're telling me that we don't always listen. Give me an instance when IMF gave advisory and we didn't listen.
For example, Sam, and I don't want to go into details, we have now, we are doing the fertilizer subsidy. I think if you ask a classical economic from IMF whether we should subsidize fertilizer, he'll tell you no. That's the truth, because that's maybe how things happen in the West. But we also have our own local unique conditions that make us do certain things. So, for example, we are subsidizing the fertilizer because we know of its importance in terms of agricultural output. We are doing transfers to the elderly because we know of its importance in terms of providing a safety net, to the vulnerable in the community. You actually, a classical economic person may find those as waste of public resources. So, but it's a negotiation. It is something they'll come and say, we need to strengthen our public assets. We need to put more money in KQ. Because when, like I've said, when you get borrowing money from somebody, mm-hmm. it may also be in his interest to see how is that money used. But basically, the facility that is coming, from IMF is meant actually to basically achieve that, help us to build buffers and deal with the inflationary pressures that we are having, and also assist us Kenya better, to withstand the current global economic shocks. So we hope that when this money comes, Sam, we can start seeing some stabilization of the dollar. We can start seeing the economy being able, the government at least also moving out of crowding the private sector from the banking industry in terms of borrowing, because right now that's what's happening. That's why we have the interest rates going to 18%, because government right now is competing for the same resources as a private sector, and it's because government has to continue running its program. So these facilities unlock that bit, and you may again also start seeing interest rates easing up.
Moshua, I'm reading an article here published on November 20th this year by the Business Daily. President Ruto cut subsidies to zero on IMF conditions, and they're talking about how the government spent zero on subsidy following the IMF conditions to end the support plans. And the state had budgeted to spend 24.87 billion shillings on subsidies, mainly fertilizer, in the year 2023-2024. But the spending did not materialize between July and September. So you're saying that sometimes we don't listen, but there's a reason why the fuel subsidy is no longer there, the maize subsidy is no longer there. You want to tell me it was because of the thoughtfulness of the Kenyan government, or it's a condition?
Sam, when an advisor comes, organizations hire consultants all the time. And then a consultant may come and say, you need to change the studio, the lights need to move from here to here. It's a negotiation. He'll give his justifications why he thinks you need to do something.
Mine is a very specific question, Honorable.
Mine is also a very specific answer. But I'm just also trying to...
No, just hold on. Drove the fuel subsidies and the maize subsidy. Of course, the maize subsidy was scrapped by the previous administration.
Yes.
The fuel subsidies was by the current administration. Mm. You're telling me it was the thoughtfulness of the current administration, or it was part of the conditions from IMF?
First of all, some subsidies are not very good for an economy unless they are meant to bring short-term interventions to change certain things.
Mm-hmm.
I would say it's a negotiation. The government proposes to introduce subsidies or the government proposes to stop subsidies. But like I told you, IMF is an advisor. I don't think, I've not seen anywhere where IMF has told us, if you don't do this, you know, we are not giving you money. But obviously, you also, whatever makes sense, it's in the interest of the government to accept
it. You know, it's interesting, you're sitting next to an economist who already alluded to the fact that there were conditions, and that's why you were seeing the rationalization of the funding model at the universities, which is actually enforced. Never mind, there has not been money at the universities up until...
But to answer your question, Sam, then, because yeah. I know the answer you're looking for, I told you, when you go to a doctor, you don't carry your own prescription. I think that's enough.
You need to be specific more than that. Fred, talk to me about what you're seeing, and is this sustainable? Because again, getting support from the IMF and the World Bank adds to the public debt, so to speak.
Absolutely, it's a loan.
Is it sustainable?
It's not. Now, and I think Dr. Makalu Muli here will agree that IMF includes condition. And any country that borrows from IMF must meet certain conditions. I'm not an economist, but I'm sure I've read about that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the member countries like Kenya, they have to take certain responsibility. Number one, in selecting. Number two, in designing. Number three, in the implementation of policies that will ensure that the economic program is successful. And Kenya has been trying to do that, even though Wandeto is saying that in some instances, they have not succeeded. And therefore, maybe what Kenyans would want to know, some of these conditions, whether you call it advice, whether you call it a condition, whether you call it negotiation, what are they and how are they hurting Kenyans? And that's how the unsustainability comes in. There's, and Dr. Makalu, you'll correct me if I'm wrong, there's this issue of what they call quantitative performance criteria. What does the IMF look at when they say that? So, because that one will now answer the question that Wandeto was.
Say again, quantitative?
Quantitative performance criteria in looking at some of the conditionality. How are we performing? Then there was the prior actions that they check in. But my concern is on the sustainability of these loans that you're asking, Sam.
Mm-hmm.
When we borrow and we have got other debt obligations, then we borrow to pay those prior debt obligations. And then Honorable Wandeto tells us here that because we must widen the tax base and therefore we must tax more people so that we meet our debt obligation, how is it sustainable at a time when the environment of doing business is bad, people don't have money, and the businesses are closing down? It means we are actually exposing ourselves to nearly a default status. So for me, I think even as we borrow, then we must be have what is called fiscal discipline, and then we must borrow intentionally, not just carelessly, in a manner that we can waste the money and then we fail to pay. Some of these debts that are due, we are talking about the Eurobond. Has Kenyans been told, have they been told what this Eurobond did? Was it impactful? Did it save life? Did it address issue of concern? Was it mismanaged? And if it was mismanaged, who is responsible? Because the regime where Wandeto belongs has told us that they are fixing the mess of the previous regime that was done in 10 years. Remember, some of their top leadership today were in that regime, and they're saying they don't need a year to fix a 10-year mess. They need more time. So my question would be, is some of this money that will be borrowed to go into probably expenditure or development, how are we going to use the money to ensure that we address our issue of concern? And how is it sustainable borrowing at a time when we are risking default? Because we have been told, you know, Kenya will never default. We're in a good space. IMF has given us this. And the last question, Sam, related. Maybe Wandeto would answer because he comes from the government side. Was privatization of some of these entities a condition by IMF so that we get some of these loans? That's a question that Kenya has been asked.
Well, I think he responded.
I did that.
Said that it wasn't. But I'm also wondering, Fred, because Yes, you raise important questions about, I mean, the sustainability of the debt at a time that we risk defaulting.
Yeah.
But let me ask you, so the budget of the country is, say, 3.9 trillion shillings after the supplementary budget.
Yes.
The revenues that we collected the previous year was about 2.16 trillion. The target for this year is 2.17, but all trillion. But all indications show that we may not hit that. Mm. So the consolidated services come to about 2 trillion shillings already, right?
Yes.
Because there's the servicing of public debt, there's pensions, there's county equitable share of 396 billion, there's the Teacher Service Commission taking about 343, there's the National Defense taking about 153. When you look at that, it has already depleted the ordinary revenue itself.
So we have to borrow.
So, and the budget is 3.9.
Yeah.
So the distance between 3.9 and the revenues you collected, if you had to use the previous year's targets, mm-hmm. is about 1.8 trillion. Mm-hmm. You have to finance so many other services and also finance development. Where do you get that money from?
No, I agree, Sam. We can borrow. What the public are interested in is this money going into the rightful use? Is it used prudently? Does it comply with the principle of public finance? And if so, how? Because people, when they listen to some of these stories and read newspapers, watch news that there's misappropriation of public resources, the first thing that comes to the mind is that maybe the money that was borrowed is what is being misappropriated. And therefore, what I'm saying is, even as we borrow, let's borrow in a manner that we channel the money towards the direct use of resources. Number two, let's show value for that money. Let's demonstrate to the public that this money that we have borrowed, we have used it in this manner. And that's why Parliament is there to check all this. So my answer would be, in terms of sustainability, we must demonstrate that whatever amount of money we borrow, even in terms of payment, we are able to sustain the economy, we are able to sustain our expenditure, and also those that we use in the development. That's what I'm saying.
Is it possible, Javas, because, I mean, if servicing public debt already is taking 1.8 trillion and our revenues are just 2 something trillion, I mean, that leaves us with very little space to do anything.
You see, Sam, my brother Okango is making a very curiously visible argument, just like the silver, shining silver plate on a coffin. It does not lend life or raise the dead. As a matter of fact, while Okango is good at raising critical questions about the matter of sustainability of debt and the wisdom and urgency of critical expenditure by government on money that has been borrowed or extended as a loan to us, it is important for us to appreciate that government expenditure, or government spending, is what also facilitates to have the economy on its wheels. Today, we know that very well the government has got, the National Treasury has got to disburse funds to county governments and facilitate the growth of various sectors, agriculture, health. For example, look at Nairobi City County. Today, they have got the first public ICU at Mama Lucy and Mbagathi Hospital. We need these programs running in county governments. Now, the other thing is that what the people should be asking, what we should be pushing for, is for accountability, prudent expenditure by government, and that is proper. In fact, even today, government wants every citizen to be hawk-eyed to ensure that all programs run properly and all government officials to be held to account. In fact, even by the performance signing agreement that was presided over by President William Ruto, you would see his thirst for accountability and performance by his cabinet secretaries and principal secretaries. And I think this is very important. Now, here, the cry should not just be about the issue of getting loans. The issue here should be about the prudence of this expenditure by government. And that's why Okango, in his argument, is just saying maybe what the people are thinking about is the money that, or where there are cases of graft, maybe it's the money that was given to Kenya as a loan, maybe. You see, they're not facts. And I think here, we must, in terms of critical analysis and reflection of the issues at hand, we need to look at, yes, history, two, facts, three, material evidence, and four, objectivity and reason. which will make us rationalize all these issues altogether. I think, and agreeing with what Thomas Friedman puts in his book titled The World is Flat, the aspects of globalization makes it a reality to us that no single nation can exist on its own. Today, when you look back in retrospect, how Greece survived its economic depression situation, it was not out of pulling itself up by its own bootstraps. It was by way of the support of international community, the IMF, and other Bretton Woods institutions. And so I think the issue of the economic distress that we are in as a country is not something that we'll just pull ourselves out of by way of looking inward. And Mheshimiwa here talked about earlier the issue of, for example, climate change. Today, Kenya needs close to 500 billion shillings for purposes of managing the or reforestation and afforestation programs that, and including the wider climate change programs. The evidence, for example, from the Africa Climate Summit that concluded not so long ago, as well as the evidence of the resolutions of COP28 that has just had a sunset, tells you that when the international community, when the world and nations come together, they build together. The economy of Kenya cannot be self-sustaining when we are inward looking.
Out of curiosity, how was the 500 billion shilling figure arrived at?
Now, you see, of course, while we may want to work with reasonable estimates, when you look at the very import of the interventions that are required or requisite for climate change and climate action interventions at county levels and at national level, when you look at the national programs for climate change interventions, you realize that the 500 billion shillings is an estimate of what may be needed for purposes of cushioning or buffering various aspects of these interventions.
So that is money for what?
Now, Sam, of course, I know that you appreciate the resolutions of the Africa Climate Summit that were made just not so far from here. And when you look at even some of the gains.
So the KICC.
Yes, at KICC, a very important hazard that you just earlier. At KICC. And even the resolutions of the COP28. And even how President William Ruto has risen to be the critical continental voice on matters climate change and action. You realize that, for instance, if we look at clean energy and rationalization for the same, that is very important. When you look at matters to do with alternative sources of energy in rural, peri-urban, and even urban areas, when some you look at matters to do with the transport systems that we need to focus on with respect to matters climate change, then you realize that, in fact, even the 500 billion shillings that we're talking about could just be a drop in the ocean.
You know,
In fact, my worry, Sam, is whether you think the 500 billion is too little or too
much. No.
Because I think it's too little.
Don't worry about what I think. Let's just deal with the question. Because you said, the government has also said that 500 billion shillings will be required to grow the 15 billion trees.
Those are just trees alone.
Yes.
But there are multiple interventions.
So my simple question is, how was that figure arrived at? You've gone to the direction of renewable energy and
can I help?
Climate support.
I'll be more than happy to chip in. Because Sam, even simple math.
Yeah.
How much does it take to grow one seedling? Let's just do simple math. Let's say 20 to 30 shillings. Mm-hmm. Multiply that by 15 billion.
I know what you've done. You've taken 500 billion shillings, you divided by 15, and now you're working it
way. No. I'm just trying to build it actually bottom up.
That's what I'm saying.
I belong to the bottom up approach. So, say 20 shillings. Let's just, for example, say 20 shillings to produce a seedling, multiply by 15 billion. That's 300 billion. Okay, then remember, it's not just about planting trees. There are all these other interventions that we need to make around, clean energy and whatever. The logistics of getting those trees, everything. I think actually, 500 billion in my opinion, is actually
the more reason I'm asking that question.
But let us start there.
And get the buttress Mheshimiwa's point. Look at the issue of ecosystem management and sustainability. Mm-hmm. Issues to do with management of our rivers. All right. Look at, for example, Nairobi City County has come up with the issue of the Green Army and how for the first time in our nation's history, Nairobi has not suffered the indignities of flooding because of Governor Sakaja's program to do through the Green Army, which has unclogged the drainage. And yes, we need to expand and come up with even with the more innovative ways of drainage management and harvesting of rainwater. So the 500 billion shillings is just a drop in the ocean, as I said, because this is initial
intervention. So how do we source that? Where are you getting the money from?
Now, one of the reasons, and you see the road to economic recovery will be long and painful. President William Ruto, for example, when you look at his focus on strategy, has looked at raising revenue through various taxation measures. Now, taxation itself is a good thing because no government can exist without taxes. But we need to have a mechanism in which the approach or the regime of taxation is also enabling the growth of entrepreneurship, businesses, etc. And while I'm sure Mheshimiwa here may want to speak about the issue of the Hustler Fund that has benefited from about 39 billion shillings.
Javas,
the issue is the...
Javas, wait. We are talking about the 500 billion shillings. Yes. I'm asking you how it will be raised.
Now, you see...
You can go to Hustler Fund. Can
no,
you?
No, I'm not talking about... I'm just talking about the interventions and about the issues of government raising
revenue.
So
specific to that question of 500 billion shillings, if you know that...
Now, first of all, the government itself, through various partners, could be a contributory pool towards part of the raising of these 500 billion shillings. And remember, for example, the issue of what Africa is voicing presently on compensation could also be a critical rivulet for bringing in to the basket part of this money.
Okay.
But remember that as we're speaking about...
Comment on the World Bank, please. Yeah.
Yeah,
and I also wanted to comment.
I didn't have the choice.
Javas, let me transition to Dr. Makali Mulu.
Yeah, because now we are going to climate change, and I did not comment on the World Bank. I also wanted to make some remarks on that. Sam, if you look at the history of, we call them the Britain Wood institutions. And they actually established immediately after the Second World War to provide some order in terms of financial, international financial order. And they have been having different facilities over time to address different needs as they arise from different countries. Currently, the main facilities is what they are calling the Extended Fund Facility and the Extended Credit Facility. Those are now the broad programs which are in now. And from there, that's where they are drawing resources to support countries countries like Kenya who are in problems. And as you asked in the earlier, the truth of the matter is, anytime you go to IMF or World Bank as a country, you are in a very bad situation in terms of economic management. You have issues. And that's why you want them to come in and bail you out. And if you want them to bail you out, they'll just not bail you out of nothing. Because there are these programs they are implementing in different countries, they will try to give you some kind of a program on what you need to fit into so that you get out of your problems. And what has happened is that now Kenya being almost purely relied on that program now. Because like if you read yesterday's paper, by the next 3 years, because we have actually signed into that, Kenya will get up to a maximum of about 2.1 trillion in terms of loans from the two institutions. And that is like fixed. So Kenyans should be prepared now that in another 3 years, we'll have borrowed about 2.1 trillion through those institutions. Now, for you to access that money, they will always come up with requirements. Let me call them requirements so that they don't appear like we have been put into a box. But if you look at the history term, I think last year, they came in and they demanded that we do away with all the subsidies relating to electricity, fuel, and food subsidies. We are actually to do with that, and we adhered. We adhered to that. Now, what they have done this year, they have come and said that we need to streamline our taxation program. Right. That's why we are hearing.
Are you saying because the new president came in and said that we are going to move away from this because it is wasteful? You think those are requirements?
No. That is just that's a local talk. That's a local talk for Kenyans. But the truth of the matter is, the strings being pulled from behind, and we must accept. What is happening this year? You have had some they are now calling the tax regime. Is it? Is there's a policy in Parliament which is being discussed?
Mm.
The tax policy document now being through being discussed by Kenyans. That's another requirement which needs to be addressed through them. But then even this this idea of removing some taxes, increasing others, is part of the whole program. And we are always in boardrooms discussing these things with the Treasury. So it's not a secret. But what we are saying is, the question I ask myself, because I, as you said, I'm an economist, is Kenya the first country to be subjected to this to these programs?
Mm-hmm.
The answer is no. Last month, I think it was in October, there was the annual World Bank IMF meetings in Morocco. And in that those meetings, actually, because I attended,
mm-hmm.
Zambia was approved. The approval for Zambia to have their debt rescheduled, public debt rescheduled, was announced. That, and you could see the relief to the minister when it was announced that we have approved your program. And this happens to every country. Look at Ghana. Ghana has been on this program for many years. And at one point, Ghana was the darling of these institutions. You remember? Anything mentioned about Africa, Ghana to come number one, then Kenya number two, then the normal style. Now, Kenya, Ghana is almost in the docks. We know that. It's not a secret. Actually, they are now under what I would call a recovery bed.
I see.
we are trying to bring them up. So what we are saying, Kenya, even as we get into these programs, we have to be very cautious. That's the shot I want to give. We have to be very cautious. When I look at this table, all of us, I think we are old enough. We saw the SAPs, the Structural Adjustment Program, which was also spearheaded by the same two institutions. It missed this country. You remember the cost sharing in health sector, in universities, like almost everything we are cost sharing with the government. And it missed the country. So we are saying, since we have been there in the past, and now we are almost there again. Can we now be very cautious the way we manage?
Let me understand that.
It
messed up the country in what sense?
The SAPs.
Yes.
You remember?
You're saying the cost sharing element.
Yeah, the structural. You know, that's the time people started paying when you go to hospital and you had to be treated. You would pay a portion of the cost and the government would pay.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
And you remember, Kenyans suffered a lot. University, me and him, because I think we're the same, when I listen to him, it looks like when it was the same time. We started to pay, you know, we never used to pay. First year and second year, we used to have boom. We used to get stipends. You go eat, and we used to eat chapati. We used to call it dialogue. You eat chapati free. Now, the idea, we are being told to pay, you know.
And get 5,040 shillings.
It cost a lot of problems. And I can tell you even the economy suffered. That was a fact. And it is documented. If you Google, you post on SAPs, actually there were lots of problems. The economy almost went under. So we are saying now that we get these programs again, I really want to urge my CS, Professor Dung, who was my lecturer, and the CS, the Thuge, the new CS, why am I forgetting my friend? Yeah, the PS Treasury, and then my friend Thuge in the Central Bank, because those are top brains, the economists, to be very cautious the way we relate to these people. They have already put countries into problems.
Okay.
We can easily be there. My appeal is that even as we engage them, let's make sure that we have checks and balances, not to take the country to the direction
but
of the
But in your view, because you sit in a committee, they're also looking at this situation.
Yeah, the problem is and us and public debt.
Right.
Yes.
So when you look at the amount of money you're able to raise versus the expenditure and the debt servicing you have to do, what would be the options that are practical?
Now the options which are practical is, the truth of the matter is now, where we are, if you combine total expenditure, that is the government recurrent expenditure, the money going to the counties, we are almost, actually, the
debt repayment.
Just a difference of about 13 billion to public debt repayment,
mm-hmm.
which means public debt is, we are almost, I think, about 67 shillings per 100,
mm-hmm.
public, so whatever money we collect. So the implication is the fiscal space. It's really getting narrow. And it means then, in terms of planning for other activities using our money, it's almost like impossible. So we are getting to a level where all development projects in the country will be relied on donors or on external funding. Let me say external funding. Could it be a loan? Could it be a grant? And I think that is not good for the country, where for your own development, you purely rely on external funding.
So what do we do?
So there are a number of strategies you can do. like one of what is happening now, you know, like next year we are paying the Euro bond, the $2 billion. You've seen a good, and I really like that proposal where we are saying that by end of this December, if the government can pay $500 billion, is it? No, $500 million. Just that would be very good, just to send the signals out there that we are going to pay that by June, because it stabilizes the market.
Okay.
Otherwise, it can cause panic.
Mm.
And if it causes panic, then this economy will be in problems. So there are things they can do that. The other thing is they can also negotiate for rescheduling of the public debt, so that you say I was supposed to pay in June, but can you allow me to push it? And now these are other signals which show now you are getting to a debt distress level.
Mm.
And you know the market out there, once they know you're getting there, then you are likely to access loans at higher interest because they know this one can give out. Yeah.
So
there are quite a number of issues, but I think that's like, I don't know whether you have.
Yes, we are coming to the end of the
summer.
A very interesting topic for another day.
Okay.
Where we take a bit of time and we take Kenya.
Some maybe I would also add something like expenditure rationalization,
mm-hmm. which
is something I think that's also happening. You know, I think. I even like what the proposal that NADCO has brought, that we need to reduce things like travel allowances, you know, DSA and things like that. So whatever we can do in this country also to tighten our belts a little bit will give us that little fiscal space that we are looking, because the truth, Sam, is that we are vulnerable. Let's just agree. But I think going forward, there's a good plan and we can manage this economy better. If we do it the way Kibaki did, he literally drove these guys out of town. Mm-hmm. So they've just come back because, you know, literally we've not done a few things right.
And you have been welcomed.
So I think we need to manage our economy better. And they are good people.
Right.
Once they feel your house is in order, they have no business hanging around.
So he says that Ghana was the darling at some point.
Yeah.
I think Kenya is now. Is there a chance that we might suffer the consequences that Ghana and Zambia...
Ghana was not a darling because Ghana was a darling when it was doing well. There's a time the economy of Ghana was one of the most promising. So it had become like a case study, like the poster child in terms of good economic management. But of course, you know now the route they have gone. So, and we, none of us wants to be in that position.
Basically,
so,
because of public debt.
Yeah. So we are really hoping that there's a round of treatment. The patient recovers pretty quickly, and is back on the road. We want this economy back on the road.
Do you see that happening?
Some is going to happen, and there's some encouraging signs. Some.
Uh-huh.
If you look at food inflation. It's at an all-time low. If you look at economic growth, despite all the shocks, we've grown at 5.4% of GDP. Never mind that maybe it's not even, that growth is not even redistributed.
Mm-hmm.
But I think there are signs of recovery. If, again, also, a beautiful thing on the dollar, Sam, there's some good news. The U.S. federal government has stopped now this whole, constant hiking of interest rates, which is what I keep saying. They're exporting their inflation to the world.
Mm-hmm.
So now that they have stopped that, we also hope that the world economy will generally cool down. And I don't see this program being taking too long for us to start seeing signs.
Okay.
We have a responsible government. The president is working very, very hard. And I think...
No, I know you're speaking in a rush, but there's a subsequent question I want to ask you, because he raised the issue of 500 billion shillings, and sourcing for that was not very clear.
I can answer that.
So the climate program that the country is implementing, do you think it is intended to correct the climatic situation the world is in, or it's also a source of government financing?
Sam, there's whole talk about climate finance. And the key principle in climate finance is polluter pays. And we are trying to get polluters because generally, Africa, I think, only contributes, I think it's 3%, 2% of the global, green gas, greenhouse emissions.
Mm.
Yet Africa, is bearing the brunt of the climate change in terms of what we are seeing. So the push by African countries, and it's good to repeat what Javana said, President Ruto has been actually at the forefront, he's now become the voice of this, is to say the polluters must pay, because we are the carbon sink. Part of Africa now has become the carbon sink of the world. And so we want to tap into this climate finance. So it is not really a source of revenue for the government. First of all, it is good for ourselves because it will reverse the challenges we are having for climate change. But we are also trying to say is that whoever is making us be in the situation we are in should pay us so that we collect it for the global good.
But, okay. All right, we have to leave it at that point. let's take a look at the feedback that has come to us at Citizen TV Kenya Sabgichuku. The hashtag to use is Debrek on what Kenyans are saying about the topics of the morning. This is Babu Michael. You're saying that I wonder what the Kenya Kwanza government is up to by keeping on complaining, and at the same time, they deliberately raise taxes. All the coffers were empty. State capture over borrowing claims without evidence are just rhetoric and empty narratives. All right, Janelle Lazaro, Honorable, will you really be happy to serve in a government that's partly owned by rich, powerful individuals controlling 11 important state corporations? Are we not heading back to neo-colonialism? Please, Mr. President, open up for consultations. Rev Harry, you're saying that to me, privatization of state-owned parastatals is not bad. That must be done on a structured manner, so long as it will bring more inputs, profits. God bless. Gabi Wakasiaka, privatization will result in the Kenya's government losing control over key sectors, reducing its ability to influence strategic decisions. Private entities will prioritize profit over job security, leading to potential layoffs and adverse effects on employment. Okay, Mwalimu, someone should seriously convince me to believe that this government understands basic economic principles. How can we surrender our heritage by privatizing assets of national importance like ASEC? If the plan materializes, even our forefathers won't like us. Oh, okay. How would they know? someone else. Government should open up for more consultation with the economic experts before reaching to an informed decision. Earmarking 11 parastatals for disposal could lead us to neocolonialism by the rich money laundering team. Ooh, okay. Gabby, again, selling of prostitutes like ASEC and its privatization will exacerbate social inequalities as private companies may prioritize profits, neglecting the needs of marginalized or less profitable sectors. Wycliffe, you say that the government should be serious on managing prostitutes. People working in government are believed to be idle and lazy. Some government officials also intentionally cripple prostitutes so that they can own them. That is how we start losing it. All right. And again, you say the government should be serious on managing prostitutes. I think we just read that. And Daniel is saying that IMF, with all its conditional lending, won't take and by extension, Africa from the woods. We had these conditionalities in the 1980s and 90s, and it didn't work. We need to promote intra-African trade and strengthen AFDB, that is Africa Development Bank, if we have to survive. Godi Baraza, you said that there shouldn't be too much runarounds and explanations by the Kenya Kwanza administration regarding our economic status as a nation. We must all see it through the cost of living and quality of life. Kenyans are suffering, you say. So much more feedback that has come to us, especially on those questions of privatization, the public debt, and of course the government financing. And the conversation continues. You're coming to the end of the year, so we have to take stock of what's happening. But Fred Okango, thank you so much for your time. Geoffrey Wendeto, I almost called you Godfrey. Dr. Mokali Mulu and Javas Bigambo, thank you all for making time for us on this conversation. My name is Sam Gituku. See you again some other time. Bye for now.